lesson books to 148, page 148. We're starting a lesson this morning about gambling. Appreciate everyone being here. Let's start our class with a prayer this morning. Father in heaven, we're thankful for another day you blessed us with. We're thankful for the beauty of this day. We're thankful that it's the Lord's day. We're thankful that we have the privilege to come and gather and study and worship thee today. We're so thankful that we can do that unmolested, that we have the freedom in this country to worship. And we pray, Father, that we'll always have that freedom. We're mindful of those throughout the world who don't have the freedom to worship. And we understand that they worship in their difficult circumstances. We pray that you'll bless them. And we pray that their circumstances may change in some way that they could have the freedoms that we have. We pray, Father, this morning for those of this congregation who are struggling with their health, who are having health issues, and constantly having to deal with things in their lives that cause them difficulty, and we know that that's a trying experience and may cause them to become discouraged, and we pray that we can encourage them in some way, and we pray that you'll be with the doctors that are dealing with their needs and that they might be met and that their life might be brought back to a normal place, or that they at least might have the comfort that to be able to live peacefully and as they continue their days here. We pray, Father, that you'll continue to give us good health. Help us to realize that every blessing that we have comes from thee, that you provide for us in so many ways. We're so thankful that you've provided for us by giving us your Son to take our place upon the cross. We're thankful for his blood, that it washes our sins away and continues to wash as we walk in the light. We pray, Father, this morning that you'll continue to bless us today as we worship, the days ahead, so many activities we're involved in. We pray, Father, that you'll give us good success, that we might be able to teach someone about the gospel that hasn't heard it before. Or maybe someone who's heard it, but maybe the next opportunity that's presented is the time that they might consider rendering obedience. We pray, Father, that you'll help us never to give up, help us to endure, help us to realize that this is a long journey that we're on and that we must endure to the end, and be found faithful in thy eyes to receive a crown of life. Pray, Father, you'll continue to be with us in the days ahead. Forgive us of our sins, help us to realize our shortcomings, and help us to strive to become stronger and do more to overcome those things that how many times cause us to stumble. Bless us in our study this morning. We pray, Father, that we'll live our lives in such a way that heaven can be our home. We pray in Christ's name. Amen. So we talk about a subject this morning that is certainly a current issue, and the one that which we can discuss so many things. And you look at it, and this is one of those studies where people will say, well, you can't find that in the Bible. Or you can't, you won't find gambling in the Bible. But we'll look at some passages that will give us an understanding of how God feels about certain things. I guess the bottom line that we need to come to an understanding of is if we are really honest and aware of where we are and being human beings that live upon this earth, who owns everything? Well, certainly we don't. We think we do. This is my house. This is my boat. This is my car. This is mine. But as pointed out in many cases in the scriptures, once we lose our life. Our life is expires upon this earth. Whose do these things belong to? Well, you may say, well, they belong to people who are left behind. The heirs get these things. But ultimately, everything belongs to God. And what we need to understand is when we start talking about gambling, we look at that from a standpoint of saying, well, it's my money. I can do what I want to with it. Well, you have that freedom. There's an allowance for you to do that. But to do that is certainly not appropriate from the standpoint of what God wants us to do and how he wants us to take care of what he's given unto us. Now, we think of it, things sometimes a lot in terms of money. That's how we think of things. But when you look at gambling, there's so many things. It's the whole idea, the concept of being able to get something at a very small price or maybe for nothing and expecting to get some great gains in return. So we're betting on an outcome. Now, if you say betting, then sometimes people might not relate betting and gambling, but it's all in the same arena. We're trying to get something of great value, of great gain, or to gain something that costs us nothing or costs us very little. And it's one of those situations where, have you ever seen the, what is it, State Farm, Like a Good Neighbor, maybe that's the one. You know, where they get into the trouble and they start singing the little jingle, you know, and then their agent pops up on the screen and they say, get me out of here, or I'm in trouble, you know, whatever. I like the one where the girl buys the purse and she says, oh, this purse costs a lot. And she calls on her agent pops up and says, have I saved enough money to be able to buy this purse? Yeah, you're good. So her girlfriend that's sitting there say, my agent, come, please come, whatever. And the guy comes with the fishing pole with a dollar bill on it. And he says, you're good for a dollar. And she tries to grab that and he pulls it away. Well, that's what gambling is. There's stuff out there and the world wants to tell you, here is this great pot of money. Here's this advantage that you can gain. But all you've got to do is, you know, wager a little bit, or you've got to give a little bit, and it's out there for you, and then you can go jump and get it. And, you know, if we were really objective, and we could pull ourselves back from the emotions of a lot of money, and what does a lot of money, or the possibilities of a lot of money, do to us from a mental standpoint? How do you think about that? Not a big deal. No, we usually look at it and say, I'd like to get my hands on that. I would like to have that money. They're telling me it's available. They're telling me that it's out there. Or I'm seeing some odds from a betting perspective that if I were to win this bet, then here's the returns on that. And I would make a ton of money. And so that's the way we look at it. We look at it from a standpoint, there's a lot out there, and it's enticing. It's something that we want. But I want you to understand, if you could pull yourselves back, it's like the guy with the fishing pole and the dollar bill. Every time you think you're going to get it, they're going to jerk it back. Okay? You probably have the same kind of friends or workers that I have. And the couple guys in my office, they play the lottery. You know, they'll go up to Tennessee once a month or something, and they'll put their money out, and they'll get their numbers, and they'll start watching their numbers. And it's comical to me because I have a different perspective than they do about gambling, the lottery, and that kind of thing. It's like, didn't win again. The possibilities of winning are at some tremendous number. It's like crazy. One in a million chance of winning. And yet they go up on a regular basis and they spend their money hoping to get some numbers. Well, The people who run those things are not, I'll just say idiots. I don't know what else. They're pretty smart at it. So what happens? You play some lesser thing that is not going to be for the millions of dollars. Yeah, get a little scratch card. You scratch it off. And every once in a while, they'll win $5. This is just great. I won $5 or I won $25. This is great. Well, how much have you spent to get $5? Well, they spent a lot of money. And it's just amazing to me when we start talking about lottery in the state of Alabama, and I'm not a prophet, but there are things that even I can see in the future. There's enough push from this state and people who believe that the lottery is doing so much for everybody that we have to have one, because Georgia has one, Tennessee has one, those around about us have one. We're having to go across state lines. And here's the argument. We're having to go across state lines to spend that money. We could keep it in Alabama. So we need a lottery so we can keep spending our money in Alabama. Well, hey, you know, that sort of sounds, has a ring to that, may make a little sense. But we need to understand some statistics about that. And I've not done a lot of research, but I've heard things. And you may have some things that you can bring to bear as we talk about this. So we're going to look in some scriptures later on. I don't know if we'll get to them this morning. But the idea we want to present, first of all, is that gambling is not in accordance with the Bible. It's not in accordance with what God has prescribed for us. We are to be good stewards of what we have. And gambling is a way of wasting that away. Now, you know, we look back, and I know I've had some slight experience with it in the state of Tennessee. You know, if you go to school in the state of Tennessee, for college, it's paid for. That is great, right? We pay for so many college educations because of the lottery money. Well, what else goes along with that? You don't get to have something like that without having to pay a price in terms of having additional government people to keep up with it. It costs money to do what they say. It's not just like a pot out here and say, we've got this great big pot of money and everybody gets to participate in it. Uh-huh. Yeah. I wish I had some land in Florida that I could sell you that's a little bit underwater right now, but I'd like to try to talk to you about the future and how it might one day not be underwater. And those are some of the realities of what we're going to be seeing if we ever anticipate or get involved in that. So far, the people of the state of Alabama have had enough sense about them to say we don't need a lottery. Because it's just lies. It's lies, you know. It's like a shell game. Well, look at this, you know. I'm getting this money over here, and look at that. That looks really good, you know. But it's a shell game, you know. They're playing games. There are so many things to talk about, the dangers of gambling. I want to try to reflect on a guy who was a quarterback, and y'all can probably better at this than I am because I'm struggling with the name. I want to say Art Schisler, something like that. Yeah, do y'all remember him? Great quarterback at Ohio State. Ruined his career because of gambling. He could have been a pro quarterback, never made it, because of gambling. Pete Rose is not in the Hall of Fame. I doubt that Pete Rose will ever get in the Hall of Fame. It doesn't look like that's going to happen. Because of something really outside of baseball, somewhat related. supposedly betting on baseball games, but as he says, I never bet on a game in which I played in. I don't know why that makes it right, but he has been banned from the Hall of Fame. He has over 4,000 hits. Probably has that record, I'm wanting to say. The only one that I know of that might be getting close to it is Ichiro. And, you know, I don't know if he's going to make it or not. Man, y'all probably don't care anything about that. And I'm probably not even right with what I'm telling you. But the point I'm saying is that baseball has shunned one of the greatest players because of gambling. And it happens all the time. I mean, you talk about it being an above-board thing. It's just a healthy thing that we do. There have been NBA officials that have been involved with point shaving that they've had to, you know, let go and discipline. We're talking about on a regular basis people. You know how big the gambling industry is? It's huge. It is huge. And the point is, it's always, I'm going to get something, but the underlying reality is, no, you're not. Because you pay stuff out and you never get anything in return. It's just like the lottery and the guys at work. They go all the time, I'm going to get it one of these days. That's my retirement. No, they're not going to get it. Some people do get it. Have you heard the story of the people? I think it was a guy, and I don't remember where it was. He's won it twice. It's like, you got to be kidding me. Twice? So he's become a millionaire or a multimillionaire twice. Now, if you had multiple millions of dollars, do you not think that you would have a pretty good life? He's won it twice, and he's lost his millions twice. He's an average person. He has no millions. He doesn't have that money. How do you blow multiple millions of dollars? Well, there's a number of ways. Guess what happens when you get multiple millions? You have a lot of friends all of a sudden, don't you? Hey, you know, I'm your cousin second removed from Aunt Molly, whatever, you know. And, my wife needs a procedure done. But it's going to cost a lot of money, you know. It's either that or she's probably going to die. Oh, okay, I got the money. You have more friends and people that come to you. I have heard people say that have won the lottery, I wish I had never gotten that money. Because now you've got everybody that's constantly, every time you talk to somebody, oh, you're that guy who won the lottery. You've got millions of dollars. And you can't even live peacefully anymore.
The movie Red, with Bruce Willis and that, you know, did very well. It's based on a comic book. The guy who wrote the comic book, who did the artwork for the comic book, is the brother of a guy who I work with. You know, he's from here in Huntsville. And he was saying, he was telling his brother, he said, you know, after the movie came out, I had a lot of relatives I didn't know I had. You know, they're all poor.
Yes. Absolutely.
And it, you know, gets back to the scripture, he who would be rich pierces himself through with many sorrows. And in this case, sometimes it's other people's sorrows.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, it's ruined. It's that carrot out there. It's like, this is great. You know, I need to grab for this. I need to put everything I've got into this. And then after it's said and done, you look back on it. You know, you're in such a state. Your life is miserable. You just can't, you know, you can't really function anymore. But that's what the picture paints. It paints a picture of wealth. It paints a picture of you're going to get something. and it's just a false picture. And we've got to understand that that's what it is. It's not real. And, you know, it's hard to tell people that it's not real when they read in the paper or online or something that this person just won the lottery and they got $70 million or something. But it's just, it's not real, you know, and we just can't seem to get around that.
Truth is not exactly what you think it is. You know, we're talking about lotteries. Similar thing with casino gambling. One of my favorite examples is Nevada. Nevada has laws that regulate how much a casino can take in based on the game. And by law, by the law of the state of Nevada, a casino that has slot machines has to pay out 80% of what comes in on those slot machines. And you think, wow, I have an 80% chance of winning. Well, there's only one way that works. You know, think of 100 slot machines. Everybody puts a thing in, you pull it. If you win, you get back what you put in.
Yep.
And in that case, you have 80% chance of breaking even. So, but still, you are more likely to win than you are to lose. If you change that by saying, okay, if I put in a dollar, if I win, I get $2, all of a sudden you've dropped from being 80% chance of winning to less than half, to 40% chance of winning. And $2, you know, a 2-to-1 thing, nobody's going to be interested in that. Make it 5-to-1 or 10-to-1, and pretty soon we'll have less than 1% chance of winning on any pull of the slots.
That's just amazing.
As they say, the lottery is a tax on people who are bad.
Exactly. And we need to understand that. And most people that are educated, either from a standpoint of religious beliefs or from an education standpoint, they understand that's where we're headed with it. We're not getting anywhere. We think we are. We think there's something out there, but we're not getting anywhere. It's set up. Speaking of the casinos in Nevada, I was out on a business trip several years ago to a little place in Missouri called Joplin, Missouri, and you may have heard of that because that's where they had a pretty devastating tornado a couple of 3 years ago, somewhere in that time frame. But we went out to eat one night, and a guy says that we were with. He said I want to introduce you to the guy who owns this place and let him do some card tricks for you. And so, you know, we got to talking, and he comes in and he starts showing us some stuff. And so just sort of the story is that this guy used to work at a casino in Nevada. And, you know, he said, you're never going to win there. Now, you may win a little bit, but you're never, because he would sit there and do stuff, and he said, I haven't done this in years, and you don't know what I'm doing. And he was amazing us with what he could do with cards. But that's how they are out there. They're doing stuff you don't even see what they're doing. And there's a desire, you know, on a lot of casinos' parts not to lose money, so they're going to, you know, it's going to be stacked toward the deck in their favor. They don't have just somebody off the street sitting there dealing cards. Okay, here's blackjack 21. Okay, let me pull. Okay, you know, real slow, can't get the car off the deck, kind of thing like me. No, they're slick. They're trained. They're professionals in what they do. And this is just something we need to understand, that Satan paints the picture that, oh, you're going to get something. It's out there. It's just waiting on you. You know, my time's coming. If I buy enough lottery tickets, I'm going to eventually get the winning numbers, you know? And it's just funny because, I just have to just sort of laugh under my breath because the guy's in the office. It'll be like, yeah, I think I've got, maybe I've got them this time, you know. I spent so much money up there getting tickets. I've been watching them. And it's funny that the lottery in the state of Tennessee, do you think people win it in the state of Tennessee? Well, you say, well, maybe they win it in Alabama because they can go across the line or somewhere close to Tennessee. Or over in Georgia, if somebody wins the lottery, it would be somewhere close by, right? No. You read as you go through these things and the news becomes apparent. It's like someone in the state of California won the Tennessee lottery. It's like, what? It's crazy. People are just playing these games. And, you know, in a lot of media areas, like in Chicago or New York or something, you'll see that every night over the, here are the winning Powerball winners. You know, here's the winning numbers. You know, they do it every night kind of thing. It's just part of what they do and who they are. And so if you think of taking money and spending it in hopes that you're going to get a lot of stuff in return, think of how much payout there is by individuals. And then nobody gets it. You've watched how those lotteries go. There was no winner today. Well, guess what? It's made in such a way that the odds are against people winning. There are going to be winners eventually. But it's not like you think, oh, I got a good chance here. I got a new card. Got numbers on it. It'd go for days. Long time. Maybe half a year. No winners today. Well, just think how much money's been poured into that. Now, you think they're going to give you money and profit that they've gotten out of it? They're going to give you part of your money back. People's money. It wasn't their money. So we're not getting anywhere. But the dangers of that are devastating. When I worked construction way back, maybe not that far back, but when I was a kid trying to earn some summer money to go to college, it's an interesting thing because you think, well, you know, people that have money and they spend money to try to win the lottery, or they bet on something hoping that they can, it doesn't really bother them. They've got money and they can do it. Floyd Mayweather, the boxer, guy is insane for what he'll go bet on. He's just crazy. And, you know, you can look at that and say, well, he can handle it. He's a multimillionaire. But when I worked construction, this is how it would play out where I worked. And I wasn't there for a long time, but, you know, over the summer months, we'd work all week. We get paid on Friday. Well, there were a number of workers that would run down to the bank on Friday after they got paid, because we usually quit about 3:30 or something because we started at 6. And they'd go down to the bank. Bank still be open, get their money. They would come back right there in front of the business, throwing the dice against the curb and losing their money just after they cashed it, and they took home so much more less to their kids and their families who needed it, because they were gambling with their fellow workers about, you know, what was the roll of the dice or whatever game they were playing. And the money that they very well needed to feed the mouths of their children was just being thrown away. Probably not less than an hour after they had gotten it. So there's no real justification in saying, well, they're wealthy, they can afford to gamble. There are people who do that. But that doesn't make it right. And those people who don't make enough money to be sort of unscathed by it, you know, by the way, those who gamble, gambling is what? Gambling is an addiction. It's an addiction. You know how most people are with gambling? They'll start out with something small. That was pretty exciting. I won something, or almost won something. Well, here's something on a larger scale. Yeah, I'm in, you know. Put me down for something. And the next thing you know, they have gambling debts that they cannot pay. And guess what? You know those shows on television where the strong-arm guy comes in and says, you know, hey, Mickey over here, he's looking for his money, and you owe him because you've been gambling and you've been losing and you've been borrowing against chances of winning, and now he wants his money. I can't pay out. Well, okay, I'm going to have to break your arm. You know, we think that that's, you know, just entertainment. That's not really real. Well, some of it is. And that's how people live their lives in a lot of cases. They will go out and they'll borrow money that they can't pay back in the hopes that they're going to win something that's going to, you know, hit them big. They'll pay off this little loan over here that they own, and the carrot is pulled in front of them a little bit farther away, and they keep jumping for it. And they'll never get there. And yet all that time they're hurting their families. Gambling is an addiction, and it's been proven time and time again. Those who usually are in gambling have great difficulty stopping. They have to have some counseling if they want to get out of it. For the most part, there are exceptions. Somebody says, hey, I've done enough of this. I've not gotten anything out of it. I'm done with it. That may happen. But in a lot of cases, the way in the nature of gambling is you may win something along the way that says, I'm still willing to be in it. And so that's how we live our lives. Well, if we understand that things belong to God, they're not ours to spend that way, then we can come to an understanding that gambling's wrong and that we should not be involved in it. We are responsible for what's been given unto us. And everything that we have, God's given to us in terms of those things that are good, our jobs, our health, things like that. There are kids today that will gamble on whether or not the chamber on the gun is loaded. And they will play games because they're going to bet that there's not anything in there. And eventually, odds will catch up with them and someone will take their life. It's gambling. And so when you start talking about gambling, it is one of those things that's like a wildfire. As we watch wildfires get started out west, and they can't control them, they can't stop them, and they burn up, you know, just thousands and thousands of acres of forest and things that we need to keep this world the place of a good place with, you know, producing the kind of things that plants produce for us. It's important that they not be burned up. And it's a wildfire, but gambling's the same way. And, you know, you stop and think about it. Go back, you know, how many years do we have to go back that there was no lottery in any state? You know, where was gambling? Probably in Las Vegas. Yeah, we all knew about there, probably somewhere. Some places close to California, maybe up in New York, New Jersey area. But it's just gotten just out of control, you know. You look at the situations in Mississippi and other places like that. Well, the Indians have come in and said, hey, we can make some money. We can make a lot of profit if we put our money into building casinos. And so we have casinos all over the place. Tunica, you know? You hear people talking that, you know, I do. Well, what'd you do this weekend? Well, I went down to Tunica, dropped a few $100 bills down there, didn't win anything, but it was, had a good time. I mean, that's the kind of thing that you hear. I hear it. I know you hear it somewhere. But gambling is growing. We won a lottery here. In the state of Alabama, people keep pushing it. Every time you turn around, they want it on the the ticket for the next voting period, and they want to try to put a lottery in. So when you stop and think about all these are things that are growing, not going away. And what happens to the kids that are growing up into an environment where their parents make it known quite a way that, you know, quite out loud and apparent that they gamble? Man comes home to his wife, well, you know, just got back from Tennessee, bought a ticket up there, hoping to win the lottery. You know, and she's, well, okay, you know, they're okay with that. The kids hear that, you know, they start picking up on that kind of stuff. Well, gambling's okay. Mom and dad are doing it, then gambling's okay. So they go down to school and they say, I heard someone say back just recently, just sort of caught me by surprise, that said, so-and-so bet me, and this was a kid, third, fourth grade. He said, so-and-so bet me that something was going to be a certain way, and I said, okay, you know, $5 or something. And I lost the bet. They were right, I was wrong. They lost the bet. So I had to pay $5, he said. And the kid said, I didn't know gambling was wrong then. I understand it's wrong now. It's out there. It's in our world. It's in everyday activities with kids. I'll bet you this, I'll bet you that. And a lot of times, you know, that was a joke growing up. I bet you it's not, I bet you it is, whatever. But there was nothing ever going to be changing hands. It was just a, you know, it was just one of those fictitious things. Well, I bet you this way, I bet you it's not. And then it turned out and say, see, I told you so, and that was the extent of it. There wasn't any money exchange. But we have kids at the very young level now, at least this story I'm telling you, of money exchanging hands with third and fourth graders because of betting. So if you just look at it on the surface and you look at the results of it, can't we see that gambling is wrong? I mean, do we have to really argue the point that gambling's wrong? If you look at the stories and the parables that Jesus told about giving the talents out to the people and saying, I want you to take care of these, and when I return, I want to see what you've done with them. Now, here's somebody who goes off and buries it. He didn't go lose it gambling, but he buries it. And when the Lord comes back, he's wroth, and he takes it away from him, the talent that he had. So when you stop and think about Scripture and things that sort of point to us going after things of vanity, and Solomon talks about that when we think we're going to get something from nothing, and when we pursue those avenues, and we start understanding the dangerous aspects of gambling, of betting, and what that leads to, the devastation in the homes, the problems, the addiction, it's real. And we don't tend to think about it. Most of us would probably not have been having any association with that. And if we have, I hope we've given up on that, recognizing that it's a futile game to play, because the results are never going to be in our favor. It's just not going to be. And so we need to understand that these things are not acceptable to God. They're a risk. They cause a lot of turmoil. They cause a lot of resentment. There's just nothing good that you can say about gambling. Now, someone's probably got a story that says, well, you know, I did this or I had this money. While I had this money, I helped a lot of people. Well, maybe you did, but look at the people that hurt themselves by trying to win something. And their families that go without food, their families that go without medical attention, or other things that happen to people who are trying to win the lottery and trying to pay their money to get something and they don't get it. Somebody wins. Maybe they do some good things for some people. But that doesn't offset all the damage that's done by people who can't afford it. And most people that are going to buy tickets for the lottery are the kind of people who can't afford it. So we need to understand that gambling is dangerous. It's not something that is aligned with what God teaches, that's acceptable, and that we need to be careful about it. He pointed out in the book that there are some 20 million Americans with serious gambling problems. I don't think that's an accurate figure, given today's lotteries. That's probably a statistic that they can't even gather. How many people have gambling problems? Well, how do they know from people who come up and just drop by at a gas station somewhere and that sells lottery tickets? How would you know that they got a problem? If they bought a ticket at all, they've got a problem. Some people aren't that way. Somebody might try it one time. But the point is, it's a dangerous thing. It's just like we think about, you know, taking alcohol. Sometimes we say, well, I had a drink, you know, that was it. I'm not doing anything else. Well, there are people who, because of their particular makeup, maybe they have a tendency toward this because of their genetic makeup, I don't know. But they document and they say there are some people who can take their first drink and they're an alcoholic. Because from that point on, they can't leave it alone. I don't know if that's, you know, how accurate that is, but I hear that being said and talked about. Some people may take a drink one time and they don't touch it again, never become an alcoholic. But there are some people who can drink a drink first time and they're on that path. Well, gambling's the same way. There are some people who say, hey, I got burned once, I'm not involved in it anymore. But there are other people who had just lit the fire and now they're going to be addicts to gambling. And if you look at these people that got in trouble because of it, listen to their life story. I didn't think it was a big deal. I didn't think there was much to it, but then it led to one thing led to another. Next thing you know, I'm spending thousands of dollars to try to get something as opposed to a few dollars. And then I got in deeper than I could do anything about it, and then I owed money, and I, you know, people were mad at me, people were coming after me. That's the nature of gambling. So we need to understand that these are things, they're problem areas. We've got to learn that in this world, we're going to be faced with these kinds of temptations. But it's just like everything else that Satan puts out there. It's empty. And once we get it, we think we got what we wanted. And then reality sets in. And it's not what we thought at all. And so we need to understand that that's how Satan attracts us. He gives us something that looks good, but then once you get it, it's not that impressive anymore. It doesn't mean as much as I thought it did. But now you've really gone down a path that's hard to get out of. It's hard to turn around and go back. So gambling is harmful. The money that's spent on gambling is tremendous. And we've got to be careful that we don't go down that path. We're going to look at some scripture next week to see what the Bible has to say about the nature of gambling or the nature of getting something for nothing, thinking that that's a good path to go down. And we'll see what the scriptures have to say about that. And then we'll see how far that takes us. And then going into our fill-in-the-blank activities after that, if we get through with it in time. I don't know how far we're going to take it next week, but the idea, you can read the book. There are a lot of things in there he talks about gambling, some points he makes, but just think about the reality of it. Who has ever really gotten benefit across the board, how many people have really gotten any benefit from things of that nature? All right, next week, continue on this lesson.